for today's panel discussion on global racism, past, present, and future. Yep. Okay, let's see. Before we dive in into the lively discussions between our esteemed panelists and the most important part of the panel, the Q&A session with the audience, I wish to say a few words on why I think this topic is incredibly worth our time and energy to discuss on a Friday evening. On June 28th, 2021, the UN Office of the High Commissioner of Human Rights released a report on racial justice and equality, drawing attention to the murder of George Floyd on May 25th, 2020. The report found that people of African descent, not only in the US, but across the world in places like France, UK, Brazil, Canada, are more likely to be victims of excessive policing, fatal shootings, arrests, incarcerations, and harsher sentencing, leading UN High Commissioner Michelle Bachelet to make an urgent call for states to stop denying and start dismantling racism, to end impunity and to build trust, to listen to the voices of people of African descent, and to confront past legacies and deliver redress. As a people of African descent, the UN has further drawn attention to other peoples vulnerable to systemic racism, such as women, LGBTQI+, Roma Sinti travelers, refugees, migrants, indigenous people, people living in poverty, and other minorities. UN Secretary General Antonio Guterres claimed that systemic racism, quote, poisons institutions, social structures, and everyday life in every society, driving persistent inequality, denying people their fundamental human rights, destabilizing societies, undermining democracies, eroding the legitimacy of governments, and stymieing an inclusive and sustainable recovery from COVID-19. In line with the findings and comments on the aforementioned UN officials, today we'll attempt to understand how racism is embedded not only in the conduct of state and non-state actors, but also in the paradigms we use to understand the international world order. We will then discuss on how our understanding of race and racism can guide us in reimagining the field of international relations and international institutions. Although discussed in many other places on and off campus, I believe that it's crucial that we discuss this issue of global racism today, as it's also an important dynamic which has also been reflected in the global migration and the current crisis in Ukraine, with Ukrainian refugees treated in stark contrast to the way refugees in Syria were treated in Europe. And reports of Africans having been denied safe passage out of the country reportedly due to racism. With that, drawing to our attention the period of 2015 to 2024 as the international decade for people of African descent, here's how today's panel will work. The panelists will make a 5-minute opening remarks following the moderator's brief introduction. Then for the remainder of this hour, we'll start with an opening question to kickstart the roundtable discussions, conversations among the panelists. And finally, for 30 minutes to an hour, depending on our collective energy, the audience will be able to ask questions to the panelists on topics pertaining to the theme. Does sound all good? All righty, let's begin. I'm honored to present you with these distinguished panelists. On the right, we have Ms. Bianca Freeman, who's a PhD candidate in political science in UC San Diego, where she's currently focusing on international relations, race, law, and intervention. Her current projects examine the status of force agreements and how race shapes the terms of criminal jurisdiction between military partners. Her work considers how other international legal norms by the responsibility to protect and gender patterns of racial hierarchy. And she's also an ambassador of the beaches of UC San Diego. So with that, you have the floor, Mrs. Freeman.
Thank you so much, Joseph. So good evening. My name is Bianca Freeman, and I'm a PhD candidate in political science at the University of California, San Diego. First, I'd quickly just like to thank the Fletcher School and Joseph and the organizers of such a fantastic panel and symposium. It really is a pleasure to be with you all. Some of what Joseph mentioned, I study race and racism in international law. Broadly, I'm interested in understanding how certain outcomes that we care a lot about and debate in world politics vary or are even ordered by race. So specifically, I consider the ways that racial hierarchy is often concealed behind claims of equality before the law and other norms that regulate interactions between states. Right now, my work theorizes and empirically examines American status of forces agreements, a staple in U.S. defense partnerships and foreign policy making, and how jurisdiction over U.S. military personnel is shaped by perceptions of host countries that are themselves racialized. So with that, I look forward to a lively conversation.
Thank you, Ms. Freeman. Let's see. On the bottom, we have Professor Lucian Ashworth. He is the author of Warriors, Pacifists, and Empires, Race and Racism in International Thought Before 1914 in International Affairs. His research interests include the history of international thought, early geopolitics, and the origins of feminist IR. And he is currently writing a book titled Worlding Beyond the West. Thank you for joining us, Professor Ashworth. You have the floor.
Great. Thank you very much. And thanks for inviting me here. Yes, my latest work is in international affairs, is the piece you mentioned. And I think there are two things that spurred me to do this, and I think it's kind of relevant to this panel. The first was about a decade ago, coming across information from a conference on Alfred Thayer Mahn. And Mahn was a white supremacist. His international relations was very much based upon race. But I read a transcript of this conference, and there wasn't a single mention of his racism, even though it was central to what he did. Another spur for my interest here is that a lot of my early work was done on debunking the realist-idealist debate. And the article in International Affairs has been a chance to go back to some of that work and to really begin to unpick the different forms of racism that existed in pre-1914 international thought, and to really kind of lay out the racist origins, particularly linked to empire in international relations, and how, of course, that has continued, and that that history has kind of continued through into international relations today. And the bottom line, I think, on all of this is that much in the same way as cities have had to begin to rethink many of the statues that they have in their public spaces, and the way that these statues link back to a racist past, that international relations too, as a field, needs to have some serious discussions and to interrogate the silences in our accounts of international relations disciplinary history.
Thank you, Professor Ashworth. Next, we have Professor Errol Henderson, Associate Professor of International Relations in Penn State. He established the Diasporas and Politics Project in 2019 to analyze the influence of racial and religious diasporas in world affairs. He has authored 50 scholarly publications, including 5 books on race, including The Revolution Will Not Be Theorized, in African Realism, International Relations Theory, and Africa's Wars in Post-Colonial Era. A veteran in the U.S. Army, he's also an outspoken in challenging white supremacism in academia. Thank you for joining us, Professor Henderson. You have the floor.
Thank you very much, and thank you for the conveners of this conference, and for and I want to especially thank Dr. Abby Williams, who actually started my introduced me to Tufts University and first invited me here. I have to correct one thing. I haven't written any books on race. I don't focus on race. I study war and culture and international relations. I'm an international relations scholar. I do talk about racism and white supremacism, but being a good Detroiter, born and raised, I want to keep my union card, and I want to take advantage of this 5 minutes, and I want to read a bit. If it's one thing you should leave with, is this basic notion. White supremacism won't just teach you what to think, it'll teach you how to think. Appreciating that, let me read and take advantage of this 4 minutes and 6 seconds I got left. Here we go. In a famous, though often poorly contextualized quote, IR scholar Jack Levy asserted that the democratic peace thesis is, quote, as close as anything we have to an empirical law in world politics, end quote. Less famously, but even more resolutely, Bruce Russett maintained that the democratic peace thesis was, quote, one of the strongest non-trivial or non-tautological generalizations that can be made about international relations, end quote. They were both wrong. Then is now a much better candidate for the moniker of closest thing to an empirical law or most robust generalization in IR is the phenomenon that we observe within and across states, that wherever you find sizable numbers of whites and blacks in states and international institutions across the globe, those who are white and associated with whiteness occupy the superordinate position, and those who are black and associated with blackness occupy the subordinate position. This phenomenon, this banality of white supremacy, is neither random, natural, or inconsequential. Yet empirical examinations of this global phenomenon are rarely found in our most prestigious, widely cited, or highly ranked mainstream scholarly publications, or discussed in plenary sessions at our mainstream IR conferences, like the one that's going on now at the ISA, or addressed in required reading and syllabi of mainstream IR courses. The banality of white supremacism phenomena is evident at the system, dyadic, and state levels, and across swaths of individuals and groups within states and international regimes, international trade, economic relations, IGOs, NGOs, TNCs, MNCs, every major letter group you got, terrorist groups, drug cocktails, et cetera. Yet this most prominent empirical regularity remains one of the most understudied aspects of world politics among those conducting empirical work across the spectrum of quantitative, case study, and interpretive analysis in IR. This absence results in part because the banality of white supremacy is an empirical regularity in world politics, as an empirical regularity in world politics, generates a concomitant phenomenon among IR scholars, practitioners, as a powerful byproduct, the norm against noticing, which is Vitalis's characterization of the propensity within mainstream IR discourse to dismiss, ignore, and or fail to acknowledge, much less engage, white supremacism in world politics. He took that from Toni Morrison. Characterization is also a subtitle in an excellent review essay done by Ms. Bianca Freeman and some colleagues at UC San Diego. I got 149 left. Let's do it. Thus, white racism in mainstream IR militates against the banality of white supremacy even being acknowledged, much less analyzed, in mainstream IR. This condition obtains because the banality of white supremacy, the empirical condition discussed above, is accompanied and reinforced by the banality of white supremacism, the prominent form of racism in the global system. And that's what I focus on. As a good IR scholar, University of Michigan trained, doing a lot of quantitative analysis, I focus on power. Racism is the power relationship as opposed to race. I don't focus on race. Not knocking on anybody who does, but I just want to define what I'm doing. I got 109 left. One may think of white supremacy as a description of a static condition of white racial dominance, whereas white supremacism as a form of racism is fluid insofar as its justifications may range from the theological to the biological to the anthropological to the sociological, and its practices may fluctuate from Jim Crow discrimination, apartheid, racial slavery, racial imperialism to genocide. Let's be clear about the terms before proceeding further. Racism is a belief in, practice, and policy of domination based on the specious concept of race. It's not simply bigotry or prejudice, but public and private practice typically supported by institutional power, especially state power. White supremacism is a form of racism that presupposes the inherent superiority of people designated as white, and among other things, justifies the construction and maintenance of systems, institutions, and relationships to perpetuate this superiority. It's the latter, white supremacism, which prevents, precludes, and punishes acknowledgement of, engagement with, or challenges to white supremacy in IR that are as obvious as they are ignored. That's my 5 minutes on the dot. I'm stopped there, conscious of time.
Thank you, Professor Henderson. Finally, we have Professor Murphy, Professor of Political Science at Wellesley College. He has taught world politics and global governance from a perspective influenced by both Africana studies and peace and justice studies. And he has worked and studied in the fields for 40 years as part of Wellesley's political science and international relations faculty. Professor, you have the floor. Oh, my apologies. He was in the Zoom meeting a few moments ago. That said, we will now go to the prepared questions of the panel. The first, in regards to Professor Ashworth, your introductory comments regarding debunking the debates between idealism and realism. In the field of IR, many academics and policymakers have historically interpreted world events and conducted foreign policy through the lens of realism and idealism. Are these lens racist? And what are the implications if they are? Whoever wants to go first has the floor.
I suppose, yeah, I could start on that one. I don't think it's realism and idealism that are racist per se, mostly because a lot of my work has been on the fact that actually idealism doesn't exist, that this has actually been a bad way to frame the discipline historically. I would argue, though, that the whole concept of realism, a realist-idealist debate, has been racist in the sense that by framing the discipline as a conflict between realist and idealist, it's framed the discipline as something that is about the issue of war and about the issue of conflict. And it's encouraged mining of past thinkers, particularly people like Mann, people like Norman Angell, for what they say about war and peace. And what that has done is it's left on the cutting room floor the work that these early IR scholars did on things like empire, on colonial administration, on the concepts of race, and also on concepts about civilizing mission. And all this is tied up in different forms of racism. So I think that by framing the discipline, as happened in the kind of the 1940s and 1950s, by framing the past in terms of a realist-idealist debate, that this has actually helped kind of mask the racist and the imperialist past of international relations and international thought.
Ms. Freeman or Professor Henderson?
Yes, so this question certainly reminded me of what Professor Krishna told us in 2001. And he explains that contemporary IR discourse is predicated on this type of forgetting or an abstraction from the role of racialized violence in the construction of nation states and the system that they inhabit. And so here, our attention is drawn to the assumptions that kind of underpin and undergird our quote unquote core theories of international relations. Notably, as the discipline developed, what appears to be the kind of timeless problem of anarchy and the security dilemma came to define the core questions of IR, largely in line with Cold War imperatives at the time. But this shift made race almost irrelevant for many scholars at the time. And I totally agree with Professor Ashworth in kind of calling our attention to the development, the intellectual and professional development of what we know today is the discipline of IR, American IR specifically. So relations between states, kind of the things that we know where material power and national interest shape state behavior were assumed to occur kind of above or apart from the issue of race, which was largely seen as mostly a domestic issue of race. So intellectual commitment to the assumption of anarchy in world politics, however, was in fact coterminous with the discipline's willful amnesia about race. One more thing I think is important to note is that at the time, the concept of anarchy became equated with the idea of the primitive. So Professor Sampson in 2002 wrote about this. So equating the resulting state of nature with supposedly violent peoples outside of Europe. Doing this, scholars stripped anarchy of essentially any notion of race. And again, these kinds of ideas and conceptions and views of those in Europe and those outside of the European world undergirds a lot of how we think about IR, whether it's realism or other core theories. But I think what's essential to this is understanding the development of the field and how, as Professor Ashworth mentioned, it worked to obscure or kind of conceal and hide race. So we might not think that we're talking about race, but in reality, we really are. And when we talk about race, what we're really talking about is power. So it's quite complementary to our understanding of realism in particular, even though it's explicitly silent, it's still there.
My most direct answer to your question is the paradigms of realism and idealism are racist. No.
I see. And on a relevant notes, what I think Professor Ashworth, you expressed it as in terms of silence. Ms. Freeman, you also expressed it in terms of the concept of race being left out in the discipline. Do you think that was intentional on the part of the creators of the international relations field, or is it more a byproduct of the ongoing wars and conflicts by necessity that led to a prioritization of certain aspects of society?
Yeah, I suppose I could, yeah. Say a few things about that as well. I think there is, to a certain extent, I think an attempt to maintain the kind of the basic ideas that come out, particularly from pre-First World War international relations, in later international relations, and to try and change its meanings so that it doesn't look as starkly racist as it was before the First World War. And I think one good example of that is the way that a lot of pre-First World War international thought talks very directly about race in terms of empire. It talks very directly about race in terms of kind of concepts of a civilizing mission, which is very much linked to race and to color. But what you see by the time you get to kind of mid-century is you often find the same concepts coming up, but the language has been changed. And perhaps a very good one on this one, and Ian Hall has done, I think, a very good dissecting of this, is with the English school, Martin White, particularly Hedibal Butterfield. And there's a talk within the English school about revolt against the West. And there's a kind of a Western siege mentality. But the structures of that kind of Western siege mentality is very much, very similar to the kind of racial siege mentality that we find with people like Mann. So we get a kind of a softening of the language, but the structures of the way of looking at it, and particularly playing up the kind of the ideal of the kind of the cozy world of the colonial powers, where they could kind of run the international relations the way they wanted to, and the kind of resentment that comes out in some of these writings about the kind of the new states coming, the new decolonized states coming in, is a very, very much kind of plays up that old language, but kind of redressed into a way in which there's a certain level of plausible deniability about it being racist.
Yeah, I share a lot of those thoughts, and I what's interesting is I think we in the last few years have seen this moment in American IR and ideally the field of IR, or American IR is catching up a little bit, but IR in general kind of appreciate and come to terms with what the truth of the history and the legacy of the discipline is. And some of what Professor Ashworth mentioned, the initial kind of creation and kind of purpose of IR as a discipline used to engage and kind of dance with ideas of colonial administration, empire. And that is a kind of tough history to reconcile and negotiate with for scholars today, not everyone, but some scholars today. But what I've personally found very useful, and Professor Henderson mentioned this earlier, it's not so much perhaps our focus is race and racism, and is the field racist, and when was it racist, and the ways it kind of perpetuates and embeds different styles of racism. But it's simply focusing on the outcomes, the empirical patterns in the world that matter to us personally and that seem to matter, like our field kind of coalesces around as a discipline, and ask ourselves, partly introspectively, are these patterns, do they vary by race? Are they reflecting and perpetuating systems of racism, of white supremacy, of other types of racism that are very powerful social constructions? And so it's focusing on the empirical outcomes that exist and understanding them in a more truthful and accurate way. And so I think for me, those questions have been more meaningful for my own work and interests versus kind of staying in this position of rehearsing the history and kind of asking, is what about IR and our theories continues to, kind of be racist.
I really appreciate Sister Bianca's point there. I'm not an intellectual historian, but in 1970, James Rosenau, not an obscure figure in mainstream IR, said there was a surfeit of models to examine what he considered racial conflict in world politics. You don't have to go back to the 19th century to say, I want to demystify some of this. And there were people talking about racism, including and white supremacism, just as Professor Ashworth was saying, and proudly so in the end of the 19th century, early 20th century, including the founders of American international relations. But I'm keen on demystifying this. So the passive constructions I'm less comfortable with. So Rosenau sees this in 1970, but by 93, Roxanne Doty is arguing that our journals rarely mention racism, and white supremacism. And then people like Paul Loren Gordon are highlighting how during the Cold War, white supremacism, such a central issue to the United Nations. And the issue becomes not why they haven't, for me, are they why they haven't or if they're racist. I don't care what they are in that sense. It's the problem with racism as a social science is not simply that, I don't mean to be dismissive. It's clearly morally odious. But it's also inaccurate. You see, as a social scientist, it's not accurate. So what I want to examine are the empirical outcomes associated with an analysis that's not white supremacist. And we can do that. It's like what bell hooks argued in a feminist theory from margins to center, to move from, and she doesn't mean get over, she means thoroughly engaged, but then to develop from victimization to representation to agency. And when you get to the agency, you get to what does a feminist world look like? And white supremacism in particular, racism in general, often involved initially a feminization of whole swaths of people beyond gender. So the races that were feminized were lowered, okay? So it's important to appreciate this history, sure, but also it's practiced today. We can address this right now, right at the level where we know this won't be engaged, and that is at the level of the syllabus. If you could simply look at the syllabi, and you could transform this almost immediately, because the white supremacism is maintained because we, as scholars are focusing on imperialism and war, they'll move to that instead of talking about I'm blocking on what's going on on my screen, because they won't engage Du Bois's analysis of the role of racism and white supremacism or Elaine Locke's view of racism and racial imperialism. If you want to, you may not see the words homophobia on my syllabus, but you'll see the Eulenburg scandal of World War I, which was a scandal related to the alleged softening of the Kaiser toward, as a result of gays around him as consultants. But is the discussion of the Eulenburg scandal in your syllabus? But the question for me is, what's the value added by having these announcements from Du Bois, Elaine Locke, Merz Tate, and others, and to looking at why Kenneth Waltz and Bob Gilpin don't engage issues of white supremacism and racism, or even the transatlantic slave trade, when they're talking about major wars in the global system? And more importantly, what does that suggest for the predictive ability of their models? They're covered under language, innocuous language like mercantilism. But how do you talk about the War of Jenkins' Ear, which in the Spanish was the Asiento War? The Asiento was the contract for slave trading. It's hidden in plain sight. There's no mystery to it. It's hidden in plain sight, so you can see it if you simply engage it. You don't need to turn the classroom into a circle. You don't need somebody who has mine or Sister Bianca's exquisite tan. You can simply do this because white supremacism as a social science is simply inaccurate social science. And we don't want to teach inaccurate social science. I'll stop there.
I want to focus on the words hidden in plain sight. And I think this is a good transition to the next set of questions. It was, does racism manifest in the creation and enforcement of international law, military interventions, or even distribution of humanitarian aid? I think it relates back to what Professor Henderson, your remarks were about NGOs, IGOs. It's everywhere in the international system. I was wondering if anyone could start in response to that. Ms. Freeman, would you like to start us off?
Sure. So this question I quite enjoy because I think it encourages us to think about things. This is an empirical question, certainly with important normative implications for scholarship and policy. But to know the impacts, we actually have to theorize and then test the impacts. I do appreciate how scholars that think about and care about legacies of empire, legacies of colonialism, and how those may perpetuate patterns in contemporary world politics, how we have intuitions and ways of seeing the world. But it's important to go a step further, and in order to allow our theories to more accurately engage and explain the world around us, then we need to theorize and test these things. One thing that I would say is that checking the assumptions that underpin certain practices or actions actors may take, in addition to those actors' interests and preferences. Some international norms and principles, for example, that are codified into law, which is, this is what I study, they may advance or even reward behaviors that are seen as already perfected in the European world. And so what we see is that international law may uphold a standard that certain states are, by definition, are kind of anticipated as not being able to meet for one reason or another. So here I'm talking about ideas of good governance, ideas of meeting one's responsibility to protect the citizens within a defined territory. I look at this in status of forces agreements and how conceptions of state capacity are often used as a guise or shield to kind of make these policy decisions that see non-white states as unable to meet the capacity to govern U.S. soldiers on host soil. So the point here, at least for me, is that it's important to check the assumptions that undergird a lot of these international laws and policies that we're strong proponents of and that are often championed as cornerstones of international liberal order. And so this is how I would, we're able to kind of answer this question at least a little better, understanding the actual impacts of racial hierarchy and other kind of forms of racism in world politics.
Yeah, I might add to that. One of the pieces that was in the special issue of International Affairs in January was a piece by Amitav Acharya on Race and Racism in the Founding of the Modern World Order. And he does rather a good job, I think, of discussing how with the kind of the development of an American-led order and the development of the United Nations, the Universal Declaration for Human Rights, how although there were parts of that development of the world order that were very positive. There were certain things that were kind of baked in to that order that either had a racist element or didn't deal directly with race. And he particularly is concerned with how the Covenant and the way that the sort of the post-war international order concentrated heavily on sovereign equality rather than racial equality and rather than on decolonization. Now, you know, he does also talk about how there was a kind of a pushback from that, that there was an anti-racist moment as well. He concentrates particularly on the Bandung Conference of 1955 to kind of flesh that out. But I think, you know, in terms of kind of supplementing Bianca's answer there, you know, there were certain elements within, as Amitav lays out, there are certain elements within the creation of the liberal world order that allowed the continuation of kind of racist elements from the pre-war order as well. And so that's something we have to take seriously when looking at the kind of the empirical issues that are sort of that are contained in this question.
Yeah, the answer, the technical answer is, of course, sure, it's white supremacist. The foundation of the United Nations, the construction of genocide, so it would have no bearing on the issue of Jim Crow and the treatment of African Americans with respect to the U.S. and also the treatment of ethnic minorities and Jews in the Soviet Union. It was constructed that way, and it was important to demystify these things. The question for me is, why do authors not engage these issues empirically and examine these empirical results? Examine their empirical impact. That's what's so refreshing about a graduate student like Ms. Freeman doing these things and asking about the empirical implications of them. And we know why, because you won't get published, it won't get in the mainstream journals. And what does that suggest? The continuation of these white supremacist policies. So I think it's important to see the implications of these things, the empirical ones. I'm not minimizing the moral ones, please don't get me wrong, but I'm saying the fact that it's not accurate. Let me show you how challenging this can be. Even an overtly white supremacist claim, even an overtly one, can accurately describe and predict phenomena in world politics. For example, if you said wherever you have large swaths of blacks and whites, and this includes the international organizations, I want to see how it saturates the question that you're asking. The whites will be in the preeminent position, the supportive position, blacks in the subordinate, and those associated with black, right? You find that. If someone says, if you look at international organizations, whites will be on top, blacks on the bottom, that's not a racist claim. It's a recognition of a racist reality. If you say in the next 10 years, if you look at IGOs, overwhelmingly those who are white and associated with whiteness will be in subordinate position, but they won't, and blacks and associated with blackness will associate in the subordinate. If you say that you can predict that, that's not a racist claim either. It's the recognition of a racist reality. Just you said if you investigated the if you predicted that there will be no women U.S. presidents from its founding to the present, that's not a sexist claim. It's a recognition of a sexist reality. However, back to white supremacy. What can't it do? It can't explain why that's there. The white supremacist argument said, well, whites are on top, blacks are white. Well, because, well, maybe whites are superior. Or there's some socio-anthropological reason why. It's the cultural or some sociological reason why. They can't explain why, because white supremacism is inaccurate. So, Dr. Henderson, are you saying the implication of this is that what we're learning here is not accurate? So, I mean, maybe we should be asking for our tuition money back. If you're learning white supremacism as a socialist, it's inaccurate. It saturates it. It's all the way to the syllabi. How many of you have Du Bois and Murray's Tate or... it doesn't have to be them. If you have white scholars who engage this, you know John Hers and the Security Dilemma. You know where he conceived of that. John Hers. He was white all his life. When did he conceive of it? At Howard University. See what I'm saying? At Howard University. Roberta Wolstetter. Yeah, the Wolstetters, the delicate balance of terror. Well, she taught at Howard too. I'm not saying you got to go through Howard and the HBCUs. That's no. I'm saying these are empirical questions, and we mystify them when we know that the reason why these things aren't at the forefront is because these issues remain. The white supremacism remains. I'll say this last part. I published a book. It won some Choice Outstanding Academic Title. It challenged white racism and international relations theory, and it deigned to draw from Africa's international politics, international relations theory. Africa could be the site of or the subject of, but you couldn't get good theory from there. You can learn about genocide and ethnic cleansing and so-called tribal warfare. Then I had three quantitative chapters. That book was not reviewed in any mainstream IR journal, including the main one, Perspectives in Politics, refused to review it. So what happens to this work? You see what I'm saying? There's no mystery to it. It's as plain as the professor who's teaching your class. Look at the syllabus. And then if the professor's jammed up, which one of the reasons I'm presently in the lawsuit against Penn State University for racial discrimination, just truth in packaging, you can Google it, and I ask you for advocacy. And also, I don't teach advocacy. I teach accuracy. You're not obligated to follow any ideological orientations of the professor. I didn't sign up for that. And I don't impose that on other students. I teach accuracy. Now, accuracy may sound like advocacy to you if you're not familiar with the literature. And it's so important that we recognize this. You can call it professional development, you call it what you want, but empirical work in the social sciences, white supremacism is inaccurate. Patriarchy is inaccurate. Homophobia is inaccurate. Elitism is inaccurate. It can describe and even predict, but it will not explain because it's inaccurate. That should motivate us to change it beyond whether you think it's morally odious or not, or whether this person in particular are racist. I don't know, I don't care. Last point. Those who would challenge doing empirical work or quantitative work, they said, well, Errol, the creators of statistics, the Pearsons are, Fisher and these others, they were racist. Look at the logic of that. The first quantitative analysis in US of sociology was the Philadelphia Negro by W.E.B. Du Bois. Notice what I said. I didn't say the first one conducted by a black person. The first quantitative analysis in sociology. Systematic study of lynching. That's Ida B. Wells in 1892, Southern Horrors. The logic that the genealogy is dispositive of its usefulness, that's like saying, because R. Austin Freeman, no relation to Miss Bianca Freeman, R. Austin Freeman, the creator of the inverted detective story, if you don't know what that is, it's like the Columbo series where you know the murder at the beginning and you watch how they solve. R. Austin, he was a eugenicist. So I guess, so anybody who write like Columbo, they must be a eugenicist and racist by implication? That's silly that sounds. And often people who will forswear, who will not use quantitative analysis, where would they go get their methods from? Philosophy, history, comparative literature? No racism found in any of those, right? It's silly. How do you test empirically your thesis so we can do what? Make meaningful policy to change the empirical reality facing so many of the world's people who suffer under these arbitrary modes of oppression, sexism, racism, homophobia, transphobia, elitism, et cetera. That's part of it. If you don't subscribe to that, it can be morally odious. At least we should subscribe to having accurate social science.
Professor Henderson, on that point, I was curious. What is the nature of power? I think that it brings back to what you mentioned in the beginning, that you didn't study race, but you studied about power. That allows it to be an undercurrent of racism, sexism, different fields of social science. Could you unpack what power is and when you define racism as well? And please, other panelists, you can answer the question as well. Can you demystify what race and power is?
Locke put it best. Locke defined, Elaine Locke, this is not John, this is Elaine Locke, the first Black Rhodes Scholar, Errol, the first Black Rhodes Scholar, what's his name? I hate saying what's his name, I'm sorry, because he's at UC Santa Barbara. Sister Bianca, are we allowed to say other UC schools in your presence that are not San Diego? Okay, I wouldn't want to be cool.
Yeah,
okay.
I want to take it personally.
Okay. So he's at UC, Jeffrey Stewart, just won a Pulitzer Prize, mind you, just won a Pulitzer for his study of Alain Locke. But Alain Locke argued in 1915 that race was a sociological. Remember, Boas is saying he's still talking about some anthropological elements of race that would, so that's why he was proposing intermarriage. Locke says, no, it's purely sociological. There's no biological or anthropological aspects of race. He says, watch what Locke says. He says, races didn't create civilizations. Civilizations created race. Race is simply the modern expression of imperialism. That's why I call it racial imperialism. It's an issue of status in your hierarchy. It has no, red zero, biological or anthropological, but it's utterly a specious concept. Clearly there are differences in people. Sure, the differences are not race, okay? So Locke does this in 1915. That's why I don't need to wait for 1970, 80, and 90s rediscoveries. These folks haven't rediscovered race. Folks were talking about race and white supremacy in the 19th and early 20th century, okay? So the question is, why do people ignore it? I'm trying to be quick. And you all in attendance, you need to blame Joseph for this. He said, I need to get over my shyness. Okay, here we go. So Locke argues that World War I is actually a race war within the white civilization. Anglo-Saxons and Teutons arguing who's going to dominate the European civilization, white civilization. So what does that suggest? The implications of that is that you can pose racial differences because they're specious, construct them even against people who seem similar. This is what Hitler does, doesn't he? Some of the most assimilated, some of the most German Germans at the time were assimilated Jews. But he constructed them as a different race of Aryans. The construction of Ukrainians to prosecute the Holodomor. You see, the present construction of Ukrainians, you can use race even against those who are similar. But look what Locke does. He doesn't abandon the concept. He says race can still be utilized by those subjugated by it, you call race, secondary race consciousness, to mobilize against it. But straight to your point, what is power? Demystify. Power is simply relative capability. That's all, period. What people confuse power and influence. They think that because someone's or something is more powerful, they should be able to realize their outcomes. That's influence. That's not power. Power is simply relative capabilities, okay? So when I say I'm talking about racism, it's so I'm not getting caught up on how many angels spinning on the head of a needle. What is race? What was racism? The practice, the policy, that's the power relationship that's imposed. You see what I'm saying? That's what gets me to imperialism and these other aspects of world politics. Again, I'm not knocking anyone that does this. I want to be clear, but I wanted to carve out where my line is in the way that I'm approaching this because I want to eradicate those types of things. That's where I'm coming from. I'm not making an evaluation of other folks' research who are doing these other types of things, which are often invaluable. But I also know that many white supremacists will exercise strategic ignorance, mystify these things that don't need to be mystified, to get us to waste our time talking about these things that we already know the answers for. We just wait to see, will somebody say it? Why is white supremacism perpetuated? Because white supremacists do it and white folks inordinately profit from it. There's no mystery to that, okay? I gotta say one more last thing. Walking across campus with a white professor who, as far as I know, been white all his life, who we would eventually get a $2 million grant to develop the data set on all the religious adherents of the world from 1945 to 2010 so we can test different theses about religion and world politics. Walking across the campus, okay? Asked me, how you like it here at Penn State, Errol? I said, I like it a lot, except for the white supremacist. He said, well, you'd know more about that than I would. I said, no, you would. I think you would. Most of the white supremacism I deal with come from white folks, you know, people like you, white folks. And he gave the best answer a white person could give in that scenario. He said, good point. And we went and had lunch. That's my small talk. People are not used to talking about white people. They're used to making white supremacists comfortable in a conversation. I didn't assume that this person's a white supremacist. He asked me how I'm doing. That's what I told him. And then we could have, that's my small talk. You ask me how I'm doing and you actually care, I'm gonna tell you. You see, but folks often accommodate white supremacism, and that's why they perpetuate it, even when they think or will tell other people that they don't. And the last thing, white folks know exactly what white supremacists mean. Don't need a catechism from black folk. Same reason you don't invite certain friends home when Aunt Mary is there, or Uncle, or just your parents. Oh, you know exactly what it is. So I don't play into strategic ignorance. I'm so confused. I'm waiting for a black guy to inform me or a black guy. I don't play that. That's a waste of time. It's intentionally diversionary. Just the same argument that white people somehow fear a new, they're not afraid. It just gives them a position, even from the subordinate position, to claim victimhood. I was so afraid. I'm 6'1", bald and black. I'll make all these comments I'll make, and someone will come back and say, like, I really respect your passion. What? Didn't I make any logical arguments in there? Was that? Was all you heard was passion? Errol, you seem so angry. I'm a happy guy. I'm happy. Okay, so please, I'll pass to my panelists.
Professor Ashworth or Ms. Freeman? It's a hard act to follow.
I think the concept of strategic ignorance, and I think, was a real good one. And I think that's something definitely to come back to, I think, for the third prepared question, because I think that's such a key point.
Ms. Freeman, any last remarks?
No, Dr. Henderson said it all.
Did he disappear for a moment? Professor Henderson. I guess the last question for the moderating session, and we'll go to the spicy Q&A session with the audience. The last question I phrased as, how do we reimagine the world in a way that's less racist, I guess stripping it away from racism. But hearing Professor Henderson, I guess it doesn't require reimagining, but seeing things how it is. Would that be a good characterization of?
Yeah, just stop being racist and stop suborning white supremacism. There are certain things your parents will do when you stop dealing with your parents. Racism for many white Americans is not one of them. And I'm not making arguments about this personal thing. Remember what I said before? It's like when you first learned that the main way people get wealth in this country is not from hard work and it's from inheritance, okay? It's demystifying this stuff. But teaching that you gotta get in a circle, you got that feeds the continued myth. And it's similar to why we need to learn, or not need to, why there's so much investment in every single Ukrainian who crosses the border. And that's important. Every child of Ukrainian struggle, everyone that has to be in the subway. You didn't see this coverage on the Ethiopian Civil War. You didn't see this kind of thing. You see what I'm saying? I'm not arguing for less coverage of Ukraine. I'm asking, why do you think you didn't see this in the Ethiopian Civil War? Though the administration called it genocide when it wasn't, but it has this magnitude. It's hidden in plain sight. Folks know exactly what it is. So my issue is, what will you do? So among the things I try to do is show the empirical impact of these analyses that avoid racism. It's like trying to understand conditions of women and women and girls, whatever country you're from, and not engaging sexism. You're gonna do something. You may describe, you may even accurately predict, you're not gonna explain much of anything, you see? So that's what I've said. So what do we do? And I'm prepared to show you what the approaches that I use in my classroom, which include having students write 2 to 3 page scholarly essays every week. I don't inflate grades, and developing their analytical abilities. And I do that from undergrad. And this is what I get in a lot of trouble from, because I read every word, every I dot, every T cross. Why? Because one of the things I understand is that folks will come into these contexts, and they're often white supremacist contexts. And I want you to see, I don't use that flippantly. I'm the first tenured black professor, African-American professor in the history of Penn State's political science department. They've been teaching political science here for over 100 years. I'm brilliant. I'm not that damn brilliant. They've never tenured an African-American full professor, okay? So I don't want you to think I'm using those terms loosely. But if we develop students' analytical abilities early, they'll begin to see these so-called explanations they're not explaining. So what I said about Waltz and Gilpin, and I have a piece I'm desperately trying to get it get it published. And whenever I want to publish about racism, world politics, I have to go abroad. I can't get it published in the United States. Maybe my stuff when I write in the US is just awful. It'll be published abroad though, okay? So I'm trying to show the empirical impact of those things, not to ignore the other types of impacts, but this one. So you don't have to make a moral argument, but I'm just trying to make an argument that this stuff is not accurate and we should at minimum be teaching an accurate social science. And that's why it's so refreshing to hear an advanced graduate student like Ms. Freeman talking in those terms. And it's also the usefulness of someone like Professor Ashworth, intellectual history, and so many others from Bob Vitalis, Mirza Robotnam, Robbie Shilliam, so many others. This would be a roll call of them, you know what I'm saying? Schmidt and Long as well, Ito Oren. And so that these folks that are doing this kind of work, so we can build on it, so we can change the material conditions that people face today. So that's where I'm coming from.
Yeah, there are just several things that Dr. Henderson listed that I appreciate, because a lot of it is just simply practical training students and encouraging them and equipping them with the tools to honestly be more kind of sensitive to these nuances. At the same time, they're engaging kind of the what are often held as the canonical theories and ways of understanding the world, and American IR in particular. Some things that I also think are important, and I've also encountered myself in my own work, is kind of bringing up the fact and acknowledging the fact that racism isn't always going to be conscious. It's not always going to be expressed at the individual level. And it's my opinion that some of the subfield is still there. That's the kind of racism they're keen on finding and looking for in the empirics. But I think we miss a lot by just limiting our scope to being open to understanding a certain outcome that's driven by racism at the individual level. And so what I mean is that maybe racism or racial hierarchy, it's a structure, it's a system, and individuals have a role to play there. But we can only go back and use perhaps historical early post-war examples for so long. What about politics today? And this is part of what I try to engage with the SOFA paper, in that if I can demonstrate and test and retest and find that an outcome indeed does vary by race, that is, like Dr. Henderson suggested, that is not racist, it's a racist fact. And then there are many theories I can use, there are many ways I can go about explaining that. Racism might be one, or it could be another type of ordering. But the point is that I think we would grow as a discipline, especially in the United States, when we understand that there are multiple types of racisms perhaps at work, whether it's individual and conscious and maybe even explicit, or it's more structural. But it's difficult to find that smoking gun today. Simply put, I may not have a quote from official X making egregious racist comment in this meeting. That's hard to find. However, it doesn't mean we can just wash our hands of these very important policies and policymaking processes that may be really shaping our world and the people that are in it in ways that are detrimental and that are not that are racist or are not anti-racist. And so that's one thing, practically speaking, I think as students, we can be mindful of and maybe even take the mantle up. And first of all, engaging the outcomes that we care about personally and understanding that, look, these things can vary in ways that embed and reinforce racism. And it doesn't mean, and no one has to speak a word. It's just how certain processes and institutions are working. I really like Professor Henderson's examples of humanitarian crises. And this is the last thing I'll say. This is something that in the review piece, we took care to think a little bit about, and that is, okay, if racism isn't always explicit or conscious or articulated by individuals or key actors in world politics, then maybe we need to look a little closer at how these laws are applied. So you're going to find racial equality everywhere in modern international law and norms and principles. However, it doesn't mean much if they're applied disparately, or if they're applied unevenly by race. And so that is largely what my work seeks to do. And that could be a useful entry point for students, is to consider anything that is kind of a blaring racial equality, whether it's law, whether it's aid, we have to, you know, take care to look at, okay, are these things actually being applied and maybe even enforced equally? So yeah, that's, I'll leave it there.
Yeah, I'd like to return to a point that Bianca was making about students, return to a point as well that Els was talking about syllabuses, and maybe in this sense, going down to real brass tacks in terms of students and professors, is there's a kind of sort of line of least resistance when it comes to syllabuses, and you even go as far as to call it a sort of a cowardice that we have sometimes about this, that we with our syllabuses, there's a kind of a what's expected to be in it. It's particularly when we do international relations theory or introduction to international relations. And so, okay, we've got to do all the paradigms. We've got to do all of this, all of that. And there isn't very much room left over for everything else. And a lot of this is driven as well, I have to say, by textbooks. There are one or two textbooks that are rather good out there, but most of them, what they'll give you is quick burst of history, paradigm one, paradigm two, paradigm three, and here's a few case studies. And there's no room to really get into any kind of wider analysis, new analysis, an analysis of the kind of going back, you know, to the confronting those kind of strategic ignorance, as you were talking about, Errol. There's no room for that. And I think in some respects, we have to be brave enough to say, look, we don't have to do what in our syllabuses, what's expected of by the discipline, that we actually are the discipline, whether we're a PhD candidate, whether we're mid-career, early career, mid-career, late career, we are the discipline. And so we can turn our courses into what we want to teach, and more importantly, what our students want to hear. And I find this as well, is that, you know, when I feel the weight of what I have to teach in the course, I have to say it bores the students. It bores them because they're getting kind of, it's usually stuff from the 1980s. It's you know, it's the old inter-paradigm debate or something like that. It bores them rigid because it doesn't speak to their world. It doesn't speak to our world. It doesn't speak to the world around us now. It doesn't speak to the new worlds that we've created in international relations, as we've moved into doing more work on gender and IR, on race and IR, on poverty, on indigenous peoples and international relations as well. And there's a whole series of new work that we've been doing that's coming out, and it's not reflected in the textbooks. And as a result, it doesn't get reflected in the courses. And our courses are kind of pale imitations of what was taught in the 1980s. So I think we really do need to go back to the syllabuses, and we need to have the bravery to say that we are the discipline, and that we are going to teach what interests us, and also what relates directly to our students' life experiences. And you know, if we do that, what we'll find is not only that we'll enjoy our teaching more, and our students will enjoy the teaching more, but we'll be asking some of these questions, and we'll be dealing with many of these problems that we've been talking about on this round table.
I mean, Joseph, can I comment on that?
Of course.
I appreciate your use of the rural we, but some of us have been doing this and been doing this for decades. If you read my syllabus, it looks like a conventional IR syllabus. This is my point. to train students in what's in the literature. So it starts with realism, then it's idealism, liberalism, Marxism, feminism, Pan-Africanism. And what I do and what keeps their interest, one, I think that's a pedagogical issue largely, because I don't want to give them this presentist notion. You have some students say like, oh, that's the Vietnam War. I wasn't even born then. You weren't born during the Civil War either. Does that suggest this salience? You weren't born to, you know what I'm saying? So what I say is to show how today is grounded in what's before. So they see the cycle of what containment is for Paul Nitze, and then under Kennan, but really Paul Nitze who militarized it, and then Samuel Huntington is their cultural containment. It's like, you know what I'm saying? So they civilizational realpolitik. So I think that's, you can ground them. That's not difficult. But the challenge is to teach them what's in the literature. So believe me, I hear you, and I read your work early on about the absence of the realist idealist debate. But if you're going to read the literature, you're going to encounter that. So I'm saying I'm going to prepare you for what's there. And then what really gets the students interest, by the time we're halfway done and I show you, you've been tricked. Now, truth in packaging. Now let's talk about it. And they really get it. They get the, when I talk about the critiques, but the critiques are already there. The realists are talking about racism, but when I'm presenting it, I'm talking like I'm George Patton. When I bring in the idealist, that's when the critique of the realist, but then you got the white supremacism of Woodrow Wilson. Oh, it's beautifully followed. And then Marxism, this can be done. What's different is when you look at my PowerPoints. In the PowerPoints, white supremacism is there. The feminism is there. It's gonna be on the test. Patriarchy is gonna be on the test. But how do people ask, well, how do you teach, how do you get a discussion going about racism? I don't. I lecture on racism, that's why I lecture on World War II. But you can lecture World War II, and it doesn't have to start September 1st, 1939. It could start with the Marco Polo Bridge incident. How about the first use of poison gas against civilians, the Italians against Ethiopia? But when you read the syllabus, it just says World War II. That's what we're going to discuss. You see what I'm saying? That's how we do it, and we know the strategies to use. And but riding on the spirit of what I think Lucian is getting at too, not to paraphrase, I hate when people try to paraphrase me. He said what he said, just like Bianca said what she said. But to ride on it is that the challenge is to get deans to loosen up so that Ashworth can do what he's talking about, to get professors and deans to loosen up so that Freeman can do what she's talking about. And that's when I bring up my own work. My dissertation was on Afrocentrism and world politics, University of Michigan. Only numbers are page numbers. You know who was the chair of my dissertation committee? J. David Singer. Singer is not a scholar of Afrocentrism, is that fair to say? But he was enough of a scholar to say, I can follow a logical argument if you want to develop this in culture and world politics, and we did, and I promise we'll do quantitative things later. But, and I'll stop with this, one of the big problems with understanding racism and world politics today was how dismissive political and international relations was of that Afrocentric research in the 1980s and 1990s that they dismissed as pseudoscientific, et cetera. I'm not talking about the extremes of it. I'm not talking. My book is not extreme. There are a lot of other works that weren't. This sort of rediscovery of racism or rejection of the West. And then even in this construct, the rejection of the West means everything except Marxism. How does that actually work? I'm not into rejecting this, anti-this, decolonize, de-this. I find myself in the affirmative. Can you imagine if I came on here and Joseph, and this is where I stop, said, introduce yourself. I say, I'm not Bianca Freeman. I'm not Lucian Ashworth. I'm not John. Can you imagine? You start with the affirming. What are you? Accurate social science. For it to be accurate, we need to talk about these things. I'll stop there.
Thank you, Professor Henderson.
Just wanted to say that I agree. I agree there, Errol, and I also rooted in history as well. So.
And now, Professor Henderson, it's time to wear your Q&A hat for the Q&A session. Yes, indeed. Okay. Although I'm the moderator for now, I'm also the interfaith ambassador on campus. And what we do is we do a little thing called stretching. It's been an hour of a long lecture series. So why don't we like stretch our bodies? It's a long evening. There we go.
Doesn't Joseph have such a soothing moderator voice? That's beautiful.
Alrighty, in that case, well, we have two mics on the aisle, but before you ask your questions, just note, let's respect the panelists. we have our differences, but let's voice them out respectfully. And with those two dictums, you may approach the each aisle to get out your questions. Any questions for the panelists? All right, Salome, you have the floor.
Hi, my name is Salome Deo-Prima. I'm a sophomore here at Tufts, and I'm studying international relations, and I'm a part of the EPIIC Colloquium. Thank you guys so much for being here and talking about this really important subject. So interesting. I think this question is more directed at Ms. Friedman, because you're talking about international law, and I'm interested in TWAIL, so third world approaches to international law. And in during my research, I've gotten some critiques, I guess. I've seen some critiques, and I don't know how to evaluate them, but essentially saying that it is so decentralized that it's kind of hard to attack such a central framework that is white supremacism in our institutions. So I was wondering if you could maybe comment on that.
Thank you so much for your question. So I want to repeat just so I know I'm understanding. So you're interested in third world approaches to international law and as kind of a school of thought or approach to international law. And you mentioned that you've gotten the critique that it's difficult to use that approach to evaluate things like white supremacy. Is that correct?
Yes, exactly. And white supremacy in like very centralized institutions that have authority, essentially.
Oh, okay. Well, full disclosure, I am not an expert on third world approaches to international law, but there is a robust literature from scholars all over, it's considered the global South, and that of course do this work. I probably won't seek to advise you on this one, but I'd say, another panelist, feel free to jump in here. I would say where I have found probably the greatest help is engaging literatures that already exist and kind of seeing how scholars, experts in the global South have engaged these problems. I think it's an interesting critique now that I think more about it kind of in real time. White supremacy strikes me as something that is not, I can make a case that it is, has this kind of centralized quality, but that it's something that multiple parts of the world have had to contend with and navigate and interact with over time, whether it's white supremacy born out of empire, colonialism, certain types of kind of paternalistic extractive systems. And so it's a interesting critique that you got. But again, I recommend engaging the literature of scholars in the Global South in particular that practice this. So names that you may be familiar with, Anthony Angie, has excellent books on third world approaches to international law, which have informed my own work. Professor Siba Grovogwe, who writes on race and racism in the African context and its relation to international law. Those two come to mind right now, but that would probably be my first start to understand how they engage these things. They both do talk quite a bit, certainly about racial hierarchy. I'd have to search closer to see if they actually mention white supremacy or supremacism in particular. But if you can find it and you think it's important and essential to how you would explain certain outcomes in international law, then perhaps it's something that you can make a case for, even if it hasn't been done. So,
before moving on, we just want the panelists to be wary of the time. We have a lot of questions, and to limit the response to 2 or 3 minutes would be adequate. What other panelists have contributions to Salome's question? Okay. Safe.
Thank you so much.
Hi, my name is Saif. I'm a first-year IR student on the identity track here at Tufts University. You all talked a lot about academia and how to change syllabi to make them acknowledge the history of colonialism and racism and white supremacy in the kind of field of IR. And I was wondering, as someone who wants to be a practitioner one day, how in practice that could be applied. I think race and IR can be sometimes a very theoretical, I guess, theory or way to look at IR. So how could we apply it in practice?
Well, I didn't want to, I don't know if I should answer since I made the point that I don't do race in IR, but racism, I'm a scholar of international, my focus is culture and war. That's what I focus on, okay? So I want that to be clear. But having said that, you may have noticed there's an international movement called Black Lives Matter. How does race apply to international relations? There's a Black Lives Matter movement in Nigeria, you know what I'm saying? But so one is like, again, hidden in plain sight. How does race matter? Much of the foreign policy of the United States was constructed during the Cold War from congressional committees, et cetera, that are dominated by segregationists. How does the race matter? Much of the foreign policy of the European powers are constructed by those who are advocates of imperialism, especially in Britain and France. The UN Charter, a charter member of the UN is fascist Portugal. It's a fascist regime. That's not a political, I'm not calling them a name. That's what the Salazar regime was. It was fascist. It's a charter member of NATO. The question, how does racism, how do you do that practically? Take your pick. What do you want to do? Something more specific. And I often share with students and people who just talk with me more than 5 minutes, please don't mistake my intensity for hostility. I'm not mad at you. This is just how I talk. I'm the youngest of 13. If I didn't talk loud, I didn't get food, okay? So I'm not mad. But I'm saying it's right there. How does it apply with respect to the disparities you observe in world politics? Not how does it apply? It's like asking a question about water. It's just water. But if you're talking about the hydroelectric power of the GERD, the giant dam in Ethiopia, which is one of the things that's fueling the current conflict in Ethiopia, as well as the potential conflict between Ethiopia and Egypt with respect to the Nile. But if you don't look at it, if you just see it as water, but I use the analogy of water because it's ubiquitous. But if you just think of water as opposed to hydroelectric power. So the question is, what interests you? What interests you in world politics? And this is why I talk about outcomes, because folks can often think of that in those terms in my bias experience, those things first, but not to stay there, but in the sense of what do you want to do, as opposed to thinking of the predictors so much. How does race and how do you do that practically? But I can talk about my own experience of working in a community-based organization before I became a scholar. But again, I don't try to put my biases on students because I'm not teaching advocacy, trying to be accurate, teach accuracy. I'm conscious of time.
Yeah, just building on that, you know, my experience from in sort of teaching is that actually though these when you're talking about issues of sexism, of racism, you know, these are lived experiences. And I find actually it's the other way around, quite often when I'm having seminars, particularly with grad students, and many of them are people who have worked sometimes in work related to IR, sometimes not, is that quite often actually the discussions are, when we talk about issues like, for example, race and international relations, they are bringing their experiences to it. And then in fact, you know, I think it's in many respects, it's the other way around, that certainly, you know, say at the grad level, that it is the it is not so much the case of a kind of rarefied academic subject which doesn't transfer to lived experiences, but rather lived experiences that need actually to be worked into the academic language in the seminar. So I actually find it the other way around.
Thank you so much.
Yeah.
Hi, thank you to all for joining us tonight. My name is Ian Bolson. I'm a senior here at Tufts. Professor Henderson, you kind of mentioned this happening at the beginning of the panel, but I guess this question is kind of for any of the panelists is if you've encountered this, because I'd be curious to hear from your personal experiences. But when you write an empirically accurate IR article that, you know, by extension can serve to help sort of dispel these strategically ignorant white supremacist narratives in the field. And when you submit that article to a mainstream journal and they reject it, I was wondering kind of why they may, like why they're reluctant to include those in the journal and like sort of what that serves them and maybe like what excuses they often like come up with.
That would be a good project for a senior at Tufts to send to the editors of the major journals in IR and ask them, in the past 5 years, have the proportion of articles about this subject that they have rejected and the most consistent reasons they gave why. Your power as, unfortunately, in this situation as sort of a market education is as consumers. And the irony is that you probably get a fuller, more fulsome explanation than I would.
Ms. Freeman, do you have points? Or I thought you were unmuting yourself. All right, okay.
Thank you.
Ellie?
Hi, everyone. Thank you for being with us tonight. My name is Ellie Murphy, and I'm a senior studying international relations. And I had a question for Ms. Freeman. During the discussion today, one trend I noticed was that power imbalance and white supremacy in the field of international relations seems to thrive off of these fabricated binaries. So feminized states versus, or feminine states versus masculine ones, primitive states versus civilized ones. And in an era where we're beginning to question these fabricated binaries in our social world and international systems, I'm wondering how you see the field of international relations as a field that will help us question these binaries.
Thank you for such a good question. They've all been really good questions. So it's so encouraging. I lost track of the students that if I'm teeing a class that will approach me and rightfully note that an assigned text or an assigned article seems to have neglected entire histories of colonialism, legacies of empire, these systems that didn't just go away, but that, of course, they continue to shape interactions between states. As far as international relations, the scholarship itself, or the field as a tool to help us kind of identify and begin to deconstruct and eliminate these types of kind of false binaries, as you put it, is what you're doing right now. Engaging in talks like this, being vocal, even at times it might feel uncomfortable, but if you feel led to, voicing, even if it's a question, just I noticed that this is conveniently left out, but I think it's very important for how we understand SOFAs, what I study, or the concept of R2P in intervention in states. And it's good because I think it puts the onus on the instructor and by extension the syllabus to make a conscious public choice as to whether or not this is something worth discussing and hopefully amending one's syllabus and just conversations in these different seminars. You really are the future of the field, whether it's IR as a discipline or you'll take these things into your own professions, and many of you may be become practitioners. You in large part are essential to things changing. I will say, and this is related to the previous question, we have an incredibly long way to go in terms of publications and how the field chooses to engage or not engage work that investigates outcomes and leverages the explanatory power of things like racism. But there have been some kind of silver linings or meaningful movement towards this. There are some journals, I believe Professor Ashworth brought up the special issue in IA, International Affairs, I think earlier this year. There have been some special calls for special issues on racism and security. The annual review published a piece about it. And this is all, of course, in addition to the absolutely essential work that our panelists on here today have spent their careers contributing to. So all of that is to say that it's the students in the classroom that are kind of the future of the field. And so it's up to us to use IR ourselves to disrupt things that, again, as Dr. Henderson likes to say, not necessarily about advocacy, but just to make a more accurate discipline and just way of understanding the world, which is what we're after here.
Thank you.
I would like to encourage folks too, as well, to check out Hernandez, the Latina scholar at Fordham, and her critique of the simple binary. There's nothing inherently better about a triadic, a quaternary. And one of the reasons why I focus on white supremacism, you got whatever category you got of oppressed people, women, gay, trans, poor, differently able, you make them black and you have the lowest of that category. I'll just claim it for the United States. I won't go any further, okay? But I think this is going to hold beyond the U.S. shores. There's something about attending to the least of these that can incorporate more without assuming, and this is a supremacist construct, that you got a universal solution to all of them. That's why I don't do the BIPOC thing. I'm talking about African Americans, Black folks, to challenge what? White supremacism. There's a particular role, given that it's the lowest of them in a white supremacist hierarchy, to overturn that. It's like the global application of Anna Julia Cooper's notion of when and where I enter. As a Black woman, most oppressed in US body politic, remember the Native population was expelled from the body politic, okay? So I wanna be clear, you don't think I'm dismissing it. But when and where I enter, only ones that can claim it, the whole race enters with me. So I think there is a valuation in this. If it's white supremacism, there's some value in targeting it. I'm not suggesting that's what all the folks should do, but what Hernandez is talking about, the critique of the simple binary, it can easily become another diversion to not deal with the main mode of domination. So there are other modes of domination across sex and sexuality, but there's something particular about patriarchy, okay? There's something particular about that. There's something particular about white supremacism, okay? There's something particular about elitism. There's other, okay? So I want to be clear about that. And it's not either or, but the challenge of some of these things. If I hear one more person quote Audre Lorde out of context, the master's tools and the master, oh my goodness, okay? So beyond the slogan, and that's what trying to do something empirically challenges you to do. You just can't, it's not just more phraseology or the invention of new neologisms, but to say empirically, what does this do, okay?
Thank you.
And I apologize for you too. If you state your name and affiliation. Yes.
Okay, so I'm Chi-Chi. I took this course a couple years ago and I'm living the experience that I would have had if it had not been online. But basically my question has to do with you all mentioned Robert Vitalis, the likes of Merce Tate, Elaine Locke, there's also Ralph Bunche, Eric Williams, like all of these Black scholars that have kind of been erased from academia. And I'm wondering, like, when we bring these scholars back into this, like, scholarship, I suppose, like mainstream scholarship, if there's harm in kind of acting like race, like racial hierarchy in IR, like discussing that is new. And I'm also wondering how you take this discussion and apply it to like a more global scale, like the color line, and not just like in the US, but all over the world, if that kind of makes sense. Okay.
Yeah, I think there's a great value in kind of taking, as you say, taking it up to the global scale and sort of thinking more in terms of international relations beyond the normal kind of North Atlantic way of looking at it. And I think that's even because, I mean, particularly when we're looking at many of the scholars, for example, that show up in Bob Vitalis's book and so forth, that these scholars were often part of a much wider community as well. I mean, you mentioned Merce Tate, for example, you know, who went to Geneva, then went off to Oxford, and then in her research, of course, taking her to South Asia and so forth, that, you know, she was sort of walking the world stage. And, you know, there is a danger, I think, that well, it isn't a danger, it actually happens, doesn't it? Let's face it, IR can become very parochial in that sense. I think that danger is even stronger in North America. So yes.
Yeah, really nice question. I think that it's a good thing to endeavor to seek and actually cite scholars that have done the theory and have done the work that is tangent or related or very much central to newer work and developing work. I will say, and this is not my personal critique, or it didn't originate with me, but it seems that at least in IR, scholars like Merce Tate and Ralph Bunche and those several that you mentioned, I would hope that they're known for their contributions and less for being sidelined and locked out of meetings and ignored, you know, along their professional journey. And so I want to hear Merce Tate talked about and discussed for her contributions on arms and disarmament theory. Like, I want to hear that because she, at the time at least, even though we know her largely for her contributions on theorizing and understanding the world in such a way that is more accurate and acknowledges the systems of order and hierarchy that dictate a lot of this, or a lot of what, at least the outcomes she's concerned with in IR, I don't always hear her described and talked about for her contributions. And same thing with some of the other scholars. Also, I quite like the point that women, like, there's a gender dynamic here as well. And so as much as W.E.B. Du Bois should be discussed, I would hope that Merce Tate and other women that were active in like the 80s and the 90s in IR are also discussed. And so we can help do this by moving beyond kind of how they disrupt the norm against noticing, so to speak, to actually engaging their work. And hopefully not just in the kind of growing literature as of late on race and IR, but actually the outcomes that we prioritize. And so incredibly essential to cite these works and to just take it another step and if you're a scholar, a student of IR, like Google scholar search, like who has written on this, look up who they are, you know, and kind of their contributions and how they self-identify, you know, across a host of characteristics.
Yeah, I want to ride on that, what Ms. Freeman said. Yeah, I'm interested in their theory. I'm not interested in their biography. I'm not knocking folks who are, but I'm interested in their theory and how it's applicable. So Hans Morgenthau found fitting to praise of Meredith Tate's work on disarmament. You read Morgenthau, you know. It's what's their theory? That's why I refer to Elaine Locke's his thesis on race. Du Bois's thesis on racial imperialism. We talk about the how do you bring in voices? I teach international relations. All this is international. This is the book that I talked about, African Realism. It's just a struggle just to get a picture of regaining African international relations that's not a big, overbearing, dark-skinned brother with an AK-47. Chess pieces, strategy. What epitomized strategy in the West? Except they're black and brown, because it's African. So African realism, ? To engage their theory. It's just like we said with feminism. It's not an issue of adding women and stirring. They conceived of the world and how to change it in such positive, transformative ways. So that's where I'm coming from, because these other things become draining, distractive to this purpose of challenge them at the theoretical level. A member of the Black Panther Party, David Hilliard, once said, he said, the white left wanted us for our thuggery and not our theory. Frederick Douglass was constructed by white abolitionists when he was speaking. He said, Mr. Douglass, you provide the story, we'll provide the philosophy. That's what he said. I'm interested in these folks as theorists and how their theory informs world politics. The rest they'll come in on. And I don't see any of this, and this goes back to the issue about, let me stop there out of interest of time. Let me stop there.
Well, Professor Henderson.
Thank you.
Your book, African Realism, is next to the library right next to our building right now. It's in Ginn Library, so if students are interested, they can borrow the book. We have a question over here.
And you can ask me, and I'll send you the PDF for free, any of my books. Thank you very much.
You've heard it, yeah.
Hi. First of all, I would like to say thank you. My name is Ayana Dara. I'm from Brazil. So I study public administration, and I'm part of an articulation college, Articulação Nacional de Negras Jovens Feministas, or in English, something like National Articulation of Black Young Feminists in Brazil. My question is how to keep, I don't know if you can see me, but I am a Black woman, of course, but it's okay. How to keep the Black people staying, I don't know, motivation and healthy to keep and to live in a country as a Brazil and as a US when it's so hard to us survive. So how can we can stay better than now? I don't know if you can understand.
In my class, I have a piece by Manuela Levinas Peak, on Amazonian IR. And she's a French Brazilian scholar who's an activist in Ecuador, among other places. Nascimento's work speaks to this, Abdios Nascimento's work. I wouldn't be as presumptuous to talk to you about living. And I'm not going to be presumptuous to assume because you're Black. That and from Brazil, that you're from a favela or something like that. I don't know, and I can't see you, and you didn't share that. But I do feel comfortable talking about the contributions of Brazilians to international relations. And if that's something that could be adjacent to what you're asking, because I don't want to appear indifferent, but I also don't want to appear as if I'm in any way prepared to tell you about how folks live or survive.
Does any of the other panelists have contributions? Okay.
I can give you a resource, and I can share it with Mr. Lim offline for a Brazilian scholar in the U.S. who came from Brazil, and she's a woman, a scholar, and she came to the U.S. before even being able to speak English and about navigating. So I can give you a reference to that, and I can give it to Joseph to share, if that's okay.
And if, yeah.
Thank you.
And if you provide your email, then I can resend that to you as well. And is there any more questions in the audience? Okay. Oh, we have one more.
If we have the time, I just wanted to say, if I may be so bold, to thank the panelists. And I was so inspired by everything I heard here that I wanted to say as a... Yeah. Oh, sorry. My name is Molly Tower. I am a founder and executive director of Climate Refugees. I'm a practitioner, I'm a humanitarian, working with refugees and forcibly displaced populations for about 20 years now. And Tufts very graciously invited me here to speak earlier today. And I was so inspired by what I heard today that I am so taking up this time, which is not mine. But I just wanted to say that I heard so many things that inspired me to share that 7 years ago, I founded this organization because I heard from refugees themselves what a gap there is in international relations, in asylum law, in refugee law. And if that doesn't demonstrate how much we don't represent people that are impacted by world governance, I don't know what else it does demonstrate. 2 years ago, living in New York City and the murder of George Floyd, I was just beside myself like anybody else. And I was cooking dinner and a thought came into my head, which was, if Black Americans were to seek asylum, they could qualify. I went to my laptop and I wrote that down and I published that op-ed. And it was the first op-ed I ever wrote and published. And I just dared to do it because it needed to be said. I have no agenda either, except that who says that crossing a boundary is what determines that you're a refugee, when clearly I use, to Professor Henderson's amazing point, the empirical evidence that the UN itself has documented decade after decade after decade to prove that, clearly it reaches the threshold of persecution. And I, as someone who has a master's degree in international affairs and in human rights, I'm ashamed to say, and also in development, that it's only after the fact that I learned that in 1947, W.E.B. Du Bois filed his petition to the UN, which kind of went nowhere. And in 1948, we have the Universal Declaration of Human Rights. So, you know, everything you all just said, just as a practitioner, my goodness, thank you so much. And I'm just sharing that because here we are amongst people who are going to take us into the future, I hope. I know they will. So thank you.
If I'm allowed, Boy's petition came from the NNC, which had been associated with Ralph Bunche, but it didn't go nowhere. By 1951, William and Louise Patterson had published We Charge Genocide. Louise Patterson is an excellent book by Keith Gilliard on her life and their struggle. They would inform people from Queen Mother Moore, who would teach Malcolm X with respect to reparations. The issue of refugees, and I'll just be very quick, then that should be supportive, appreciating what you said, of a argument for reparations if that type of persecution continues, especially since we're here talking about policy implications with just the recent passage of the Emmett Till anti-lynching bill. And if you remember, one of the main protagonists of the or one of the protagonists, the white woman who that Emmett had been inappropriate toward her, she finally recanted it, or she finally told the truth right before she died, and she was selling her own book, Bryant, Miss Bryant. Just the point about it going nowhere, And the part, the refugee part, I get it, the empirical relationship. African Americans have never been refugees in this country. They're much more following the Native Americans, have the longest and sustained citizenship claims to this country and the establishment of the most democratic institutions that this country has. So that's the one part of refugee part that I'm not with, but I appreciate the point that the circumstances that they face. But it was like with Hurricane Katrina, when they're talking about these folks as refugees, they're citizens, they're not refugees, but they're treated as if they are. So the language I would encourage, if Blacks are persecuted as refugees, then this becomes a justification for reparations and international law, and maybe the freeing of the political prisoners, of Black political prisoners from Mutulu Shakur, from Sekou Dinga, who was released after 33 years, and Sundi Adakoli, who still is in a prison today, and Rochelle McGee, who's associated with the case, associated with Angela Davis, who's been in prison for half a century. So these issues become salient as well for activism and actions that can be taken now. Still, I'm still in the context of international law, and it may not sound like this to some people. I'm talking international relations right now. All those things I talk about, international relations, okay? So I want to stop there.
Thank you.
Hello, if I may ask real quick. I'm
Yannis.
Yeah, yeah. I'm Yannis. I'm a senior undergraduate of international relations in Athens, Greece. And I was thinking that the United Nations was constructed after the Second World War in a world that colonies still existed. And as a system in general, reflects a total different belief system, even from the, as we said, that the colonies still existed, and also the Security Council with veto right and so on, that is granted only to 5 members and stuff. So I was wondering that how we can combat the racism as an international community and gain a higher level of inclusion, while the structures that we have that have been made in a total different historical context, irrelevant of the today's reality, and how we can dismiss and discard this substantial component of today's international order.
That's a big question.
Before anyone says, I don't want to appear to be avoiding the question, but what I said before, I don't teach advocacy, I teach accuracy. So that's why I'm going to defer to the panelists.
My excellent questions, quite worthy of discussing. I am probably in the academic kind of my hat on. And so we often kind of, again, evaluate these outcomes. But in terms of creating more kind of anti-racist policy or making these policy changes, that's kind of beyond at least where my experience lies. But you bring up very obviously incredibly important international actors. And one thing I like to at least believe is that the profession and at least the academic profession, thinking through kind of policy implications, it would seem to me that it's important to understand, in addition to the actors, their interests, kind of where they relate relationally to each other in terms of material capability, power. It's simply important to understand just empirically, that could be qualitatively or statistically, how certain outcomes, especially that the big 5 members on the Security Council have all the decision-making power, how certain decisions or outcomes, whether it's human rights, so I consider the decision to intervene under the principle of R2P, whether it's aid, whether it's even NATO, I don't think has been brought up yet, and the decision to go to war, these types of decisions we can look at, like we have the numbers, and to understand the ways that they may vary by constructions of both race and racism. And so I think that this is something that one can do, whether they have both feet in the academy or both feet firmly in the policy world, or maybe one in both, which is a much more complicated. But I'd like to think that when we think about, if we're trying to create anti-racist policies and approaches, then it would seem to me that to start, it's not so much, do we have a policy or a law in place that is against racial discrimination or EDI efforts or whatever buzzwords one can imagine and think up that are floating around. It's not so much that, because again, our whole conversation has been the ways that IR conceals and obfuscates, yet perpetuates these types of systems. But it's more looking at the outcomes that you yourself as a student care about, you think about, and just asking, I wonder if this policy is applied differently depending on the geographic location or the actors of interest, the target community. We look at the news and what's happening with Ukraine, and a lot of people are talking about the differential treatment towards refugees based on perceived race. So I would say don't have an answer for policy recommendations at all, because it's a hard thing, and that's not my training at the moment. But just looking at the outcomes and just asking the question and conducting the investigation. I did a policy master's before my PhD in political science. So I had somewhat of your experience in the program that you're in. I think that that's a common theme, and I'm happy that that's a common theme between types of professions, at least at the student level.
Yeah, I'd just like to add to that, just briefly, that, we have inherited structures from the past, and often a past that's a very much a foreign country. But it's worth remembering, one more positive note, that the structures may be inherited, but the norms within those structures and also acting on those structures are constantly changing. So there's always that room for change, even if the outward form of the structures still seems to be from, our grandparents' generation.
Thank you.
Hi, my name is Kieran Gore. I'm an attorney. I think I'm the only attorney in the room, but I think we have some law students from Brazil and some of the other delegations here. I practice public international law, and I primarily focus on international economic law and international investment law. And Tufts graciously invited me to talk about R2P tomorrow. So that has very little to do with economic law, but has implications. I wanted to share a reference and a resource that I started to look up over dinner. And I wish you were all here with us for dinner, because the students are delightful and inquisitive, and you have gotten a lot out of that. But earlier this week, Professor James Guythe of Loyola Law School in Chicago gave a lecture at Brooklyn Law School where his primary thesis, and it's one that he's continuing to develop, and I hope he'll publish a paper about it soon, but it was just a lecture that he gave on Zoom, was that in order to unpack the racist legacy of some of these institutions, or the race-based legacy of institutions that we have today, we have to go back in history and see how their racist agenda has unfolded. What does that really mean? Well, he looks at the World Bank's reaction to the murder of George Floyd, which was to start an anti-racism task force. That task force had two prongs to it. The first thing was to look at internal policy. So how do employees at the World Bank experience their time working there and things like that? But then also to look at the developmental agenda that the World Bank presently has. And what he theorizes is that it's impossible to unpack any of that without going back to the origins of the World Bank and looking at what they funded, when they funded it, what were the race-based prerogatives or motivations for that funding. And it's only when you own up to that history that you can look at the future of the institution, both for the lived experience of people who work there, but then also their developmental agenda. So it's not an area I purport to know anything about, but it was an event that took place earlier this week. I was inspired by it. I hope he publishes a paper. So if any of you are interested in this topic, I think you can look at the work of James Guythe, and he's one of the scholars of third world approaches to international law. So you might enjoy his work. Thank you.
I appreciate the point. I don't agree with the only and it's impossible. I share with students, I'm absolutely opposed to absolutes and dogmatically against dogma. But if that's just a turn of phrase, then that's fine. There's a piece about Raphael Lemkin's that I referred to before, the construction of the Genocide Convention. These things are, as some would call, racialized to start with. I don't think you have to go back. And there was a reparations claim made against Aetna that was successful in Illinois for its financing of slave ships. You can engage these things contemporaneously. There's not necessarily an either or, so I'm not opposed to it. Only when it said the language of you can only do this, or impossible to unpack this. Look at African-American Civil War veteran, George Washington Williams, and observing what was going on toward the end of the 19th century in the Belgian Congo, coined the term that we use now. They were not simply crimes, they were crimes against humanity, okay? I think it's important that we recognize that it's not simply the hypocrisy, but the notion that the Belgians, who killed more than 10 million in Congo, would now be presiding the EU and the Brussels and the ICJ and the others. But they would be in the position as a regime. We're not even getting to the collaboration between Belgium, France, the US, and the assassination of Lumumba. It's not just the assassination of a person, but it's killing Congolese democracy. Congolese democracy was not stillborn, it was murdered in his grave. And the 32 years of Mobutuism, yet they would then focus on Paul Kagame, who overthrows that murderous regime that was subsidized by Belgium, France, the United States. And now these are the folks who are gonna hold African leaders or call them to the world court. You don't need to study all this history to see that this is, I ain't know the word for it, it's beyond hypocrisy. This is the hubris, the audacity of white supremacism. So that these folks will preside over the determinant. The French, with respect to the Rwandan genocide, to be in a position to talk about anyone being a war criminal, are you serious? I think it's appropriate to have attention first to Ukraine, but I wish more folks would focus on the Ukrainian mercenaries operating in Africa, and that have been for decades, the aegis of Western support. And these become our moral teachers. Are you serious? So the claims of what we can or can't do is just a matter of challenging what is as apparent as the nose on your face. This doesn't take some deep study, a deep dive in the history, okay? It's not required, it's there. But who will challenge that? And there are many people who are, but my challenge, what I'm trying to do is to bring this into the mainstream. I'm not interested in boutique studies or things like that. I want to bring it right into the mainstream because it is mainstream. And I hope before we close, I can leave you with a little precis. I won't do it now, but see if Joseph will allow me on how to immediately demonstrate to folks the importance of white supremacism in world politics with just four easy questions, okay? I'll stop.
Yes. Thank you for the citation and kind of the gist of this scholar's argument. And I think it's, I'm not experienced with these types of more historical approaches to these important questions. One thing that kind of a light bulb for me, especially when I was earlier in a particular paper, is that it's not a stretch of the imagination to engage the time period of the early post-war period and find racism everywhere. And so what is it telling us about, now the contextual history is absolutely important, perhaps for understanding trends over time and having that kind of institutional knowledge, there's definitely a use for it. And what's interesting is scholars like Sultan Hussas, who's an IR scholar, identifies as such and has written on things relating to race and racism in IR. He talks about how there's a pendulum and it swings. And so just because race and like the word race and certainly racism, you won't find it written anywhere except that we're against racism now. Even though racial hierarchy is kind of hidden, or at least it's not as explicit, it can swing the other way. So, and I'm using this as an analogy to talk about IOs, Brenton Woods, that may have had these very like explicitly racist actors, employed mostly Europeans in positions of power, and certainly not all of them, but you had certain actors, the same thing, politics in the United States, of course, policymakers that were very vocal about their biases and their opinions of people outside of Europe. And that's just, of course, a fact. And so, but looking at that time, it's not at all surprising, because that was the norm, that those were the customs, and there were laws that protected that. But now today, I think we're finding, and this is a point that Professor Ashworth brought up, and that the norms have certainly changed just on paper, legally. But it doesn't mean that these things, racial hierarchy, isn't still operating, of course. And so what I found very exciting is looking at data from today, and looking at it in such a way and seeing if it can be explained by perhaps the same racial structures, perhaps new ones, ones that have evolved. But looking at the World Bank today, which I know some IR scholars are already doing, who is currently employed and what are their positions in these IOs, who's making the decisions of where to, in the type of aid that goes, who is on the ground receiving the aid and gets to make these decisions. And again, I'm not an expert on aid or this kind of this area in particular in IOs. There's excellent work out there already. But yes, that there was a light bulb for me when someone told me that at the time, is that we're not surprised at all to find these things when we delve back in time. But it can be a particularly useful example or even case study to pair with analysis, empirical analysis of what's happening today. And I seem to think that that's kind of an important frontier in where positivists, mainstream scholars can, that identify as positivists, can step in and really engage that kind of work.
Thank you so much. Well, panelists, I will give you a mission, for a parting mission. It is 9 p.m. and it's time for our students to go. In 1 minute, you can make a final remark or with the common denominator with the students. If you have any plans this upcoming weekend that you're looking forward to, feel free to use this time. And Professor Henderson, you gave me a really good cliffhanger regarding your questions. And so if you want to use that time for expounding on what you wanted to expound on, you can do so, but 1 minute strictly.
Okay, 1 minute. Hold me to it, Joseph. Appreciate it. Thank you all for coming out as well. Here we go. How do you demonstrate the relevance of white supremacists in IR? Four quick questions. Is international war a major focus of IR? Yes. What was the most destructive war in recorded history? World War II. Though we know that wars are the result of complex factors, not a single one, but let's just say, if we could say there was one person responsible for making World War II, who would that be? Adolf Hitler. Were Adolf Hitler's policies white supremacists? Yes. So white supremacism was a prominent factor in the most destructive international war in human history, the study of such wars being a major focus of IR, then white supremacism is central to IR. That's it.
Seconds, so it's pretty amazing. Professor Ashworth?
I like that. I thought that was great, Errol. And actually should have been, I think, you know, that's where we should end. But no, I just wanted to say, look, this has been a great discussion, and I really thoroughly enjoyed it. And the questions have been great. They've I think they've really brought out a lot of the points that some really good points there. And basically, you know, I think this has been a great time. Look, I thank you for coming out, for listening to us, and for asking such great questions.
And finally, Ms. Freeman.
I echo what the other panelists have said, I'd like to thank you all for your time and energy. I know it's been a long, probably several days, and just making it a point to kind of bridge these worlds, which are clearly both contending with questions of how to deal and contend with race and racism in the field of international relations. And so it's so nice as a fellow student to hear your questions and gauge your excitement and just your passion, but also interest in producing more hopefully accurate policy. So I'd like to thank you so much. I'm spoiled. I'm on the West Coast, so it's not quite 9 p.m. But it's been a wonderful time. And please do reach out if I can assist you in any way as you move forward.
Mm-hmm. Well, with that, to share a little anecdote, somebody wrote on the notepad, hi, Joseph, you got this, be confident, smile. I send this message to you, be confident, smile. And I hope you have a good night ahead. Panelists, thank you so much. And could we get them a round of applause? Oh, time to party. All right, hope you have a good night ahead.
Bye, everyone.
Bye. It was a pleasure, as always.
This was so wonderful, Mrs. Freeman. Be free. Be free. Thank you, Lucia.
Thanks. Thanks, Bianca. It was wonderful. Wonderful.
This was so nice. Thank you, Joe. And thank you, Anastasia.
Yes.
Thank you so much.
Yes, thank you. Thank you.
And Gabriel, the archangel. Thank you.
Shout out to Gabriel, the archangel.
Okay, bye-bye.
Okay, have a good evening.
See you next time.